Hey guys, it's Josh again. I'm here with a new video, and this one is actually really special because I have my mom here with me, and she's read the last Legend trilogy that I wrote, and she's actually been one of an avid reader from the very beginning. Always is a big support, and she has, helped, had opinions and different things throughout the process of me writing, and she read all three books. And I'm actually going to sit and interview her. I have a couple questions, and she's gonna give you her thoughts on it. So let's get started.
All right, I'm ready.
All right, Mom, well, thank you for coming to this interview.
And thank you for inviting me. I'm glad to be here.
Oh, you're welcome. So the first question I have for you is, what is The Last Legend to you?
The Last Legend to me, these books really inspired me because I actually compare my life, what goes on in my life every day, and what goes on in this world. So I can relate, even though it's a fantasy book, but I can relate to it.
Reading. Me observing different people's lives and what they went through. Mm-hmm. And so that is very, very exciting to me that someone could relate to it. Mm-hmm. So how is this book different from other fantasies, in your opinion?
My opinion, you see, I'm not really a reader, but this fantasy book, The Last Legend, to me, like I said, I can relate. I can relate to it because it really stands out. And you know, I don't really want to go too much into the book, but this is an awesome fantasy book because I'm telling you, if you sit and you read this book and you follow it, you are gonna say, hey, you know, this sounds real. So it is an awesome fantasy book.
So was it easy to read?
Yes,
it
was.
Did it pull you in?
Yes, it did. It did pull me in. Like I said, there's a lot of excitement and just so much in this book. But you know what? Actually, this book, see, I've always was interested in Josh, it slipped my mind. You know, when you go back to that era,
the medieval
and the Renaissance.
Yeah, this book is actually set, it's supposed to be set in a medieval going on to a Renaissance period.
And it's interesting. I like that kind of book, you know. So I just forgot something. What was your question again?
Sorry. Did it pull you in?
Yes, it did. It pulled me right on in.
It wasn't easy to read.
Yes, it was very easy to read. I mean, I couldn't put the book down. So I, like I said, I don't really complete books, but this, the three books I finished, and like I said, it touched me.
Now, The Last Legend, like, people think, a lot of people think medieval Renaissance, they're thinking like, oh, you know, we're gonna have weird names and thee and thou and Shakespearean old English quotes or whatever, but the way they speak is how I wrote it, the way we speak in modern time.
Yes.
I mean, it's a fantasy. It's inspired by real life, but I made it how we would interact with each other. Mm-hmm. So it's not like you're reading a Shakespeare play.
No,
you're trying
not
to understand a Shakespeare play. No. You're reading it, and you can. It's so it's easy for you to relate to.
But of course, I can picture, you know, mm-hmm. like the castle, and you know the way they dressed that back then, and you know all that. I could picture. I really get into it.
So how was the excitement And so for excitement, I'm going to say drama, thrills, adventure, action, horror, love themes, emotion. So in these genres, what did you think? For like drama and thrills?
Like everyday world, like what we go through, what, you know, each day. I mean, you know, there's always drama. And that's what, you know, this, I mean, there is good drama in here. It's, if you like horror, no, but all everything that he has mentioned, drama, thrills, action, horror, all in this book is very good. But like I said, I'm not going to really get into this book, because if I do, I won't be quiet. I'll just keep rapping, you know, just keep on and on and on. But yes, it's very good.
And what about, there in this book, there's a big love theme between the main character, his name is Taryn.
Yes.
And Princess Marissa, who is the redhead girl. You see the redhead girl. You see a picture back there on the front cover.
Yes.
And I've mentioned before, she represents the world. But there is a love theme between Taryn and Marissa. Taryn, in my story, is actually inspired by Jesus. And the redhead girl was inspired by the world. Jesus loved the world so much that he gave his life. Taryn loved Marissa so much that he was risking his life, and he was putting himself in harm's way and even willing to die. Okay. He's willing to die for her. So there's a love theme that goes on. What did you think of the love scene, and how did it touch you?
You know, it is so easy to say, I love you. But this character, Taryn, he really did love Marissa. And it just touched me because just what he went through for her. I mean, he basically was going to lay his life down for her. And this is how much he loved her. I mean, we can say every day, oh, we love you. But are you willing to risk your life for someone that you say you love? But anyhow, the love that they have, Marissa wasn't, you know, her character, she's young, you know. She's like a free spirit person. But Taryn, he knows who he is, and he knows what he wants. So, Taryn, he had a really, really deep love for Marissa. And, you know, as you read, you'll find out for yourself, you know. Like I said, this fantasy book is awesome.
And that was, that love, as I wanted to keep alive, is because that, throughout the book, that's who you're really rooting for. In my opinion, when I wrote it, that's why I wanted you to really root for Taryn, and really want you to be
there for Marissa. Well, not only that, the love like he had for Marissa is like how Christ loves us. That he laid his life down for us. That's true love.
Mm-hmm. So that actually goes on to our next questions, because let's talk about the characters. So first we're going to start off with the side characters. They're the side characters. And when you read the book, you'll know there's Moral, who is Taryn's mother. There's Sora, who is Lady Natalia. She's called the Lady Natalia Ducre, but we just call her Natalia. That's her aunt. There's Lord Fernand, who is Lady Natalia's father. There's Jolpin, who is Marissa's father, King Jolpin. Then we have Velegna, Delcia. So what did you think about Moral, Sora?
Well, what I can recall, because it's just been a little while, but Moral is Taryn's mother.
Yeah.
Her character, she's sweet. You know, she's a caring mother, and she owns a little shop, and she, her character, she's just a sweet, bubbly person, you know, living everyday life, like we all do. And, Sora was Lady Christiane.
Lady Christiane, Natalia's mother.
That's Natalia's aunt, Sora. And she was more like she was a servant. she actually took care of Natalia. Lady Natalia, right? Mm-hmm. And, but she was there. She's a strong woman. She's like a character that speaks forward.
And these characters that I wrote, you'll find, you'll see a pattern. The characters, they kind of start off, some of them start off very abrupt and presumptuous and rude. Some of them start off kind of very, very humble, kind of, I don't want to use the word weak, but their character was, personally wasn't really strengthened, but you'll find as you read it, these characters, they strengthen and they
get strong.
The bold, presumptuous, rude ones get humble and they humble themselves. And then the more humbled ones, the more meek that I should use, they really become strengthened. Mm-hmm. They become very bold.
Strong and bold, like a warrior.
Exactly. So those were the side characters. And the side characters, I call them side characters, but they're actually main characters too. They're just not the main characters, as we're going to talk to next. But the side characters added them in there because they have some very powerful, relatable stories that were actually inspired by people I know. All these characters were inspired by people I know. But their stories were very important as well, and you'll find that out when you read it. So the main characters, we have the Lady Natalia, which I've mentioned, Prince Philip, Marissa, and Taryn. Those are the four main characters, and they're the four that they go on a big adventure. What'd you think about them, Natalia?
There was some characters, actually Natalia, I was like, I don't know about her, but Prince Philip, he was more arrogant, you know, I mean, he is, gonna be the next king in this kingdom, yeah, so he is more, arrogant and, you know, what goes along with arrogant. And Natalia is, she's young, but she, well, because, you know, her mother was really never there in the picture. Her aunt Sora is basically raised her, but Natalia's personality was, I find her, like, she needed attention from males, because her father was always traveling, so he wasn't there in the picture really too much.
Lord Fernand, and he's travels and he's a businessman. Mm-hmm. He's actually called the Marquis. If you don't know anything about what a Marquis is, he's no nobility, but he's kind of higher up in the social ranking, and he was never really there. But he's very well known, very, very wealthy. They're the wealthiest family in the country. Mm-hmm. So everybody knew who they were. Mm-hmm. Everybody knew who Natalia was. They knew who her father was, the mother. So they had a lot of opinions about this family. Natalia, you know, my mom says, oh, she's okay. But, you know, she had her struggles, but she was known as the unconventional lady. She wasn't like the other ladies who,
she was more tomboyish, I find.
She was kind of like a tomboy in a pretty dress.
Yeah.
And she was very bold when she spoke.
Yes.
And she, I hate to use this term, but her mannerism was more, as a man's, mentality at that time. She was very bold when she spoke, and she didn't really listen or obey rules. So that's why she was unconventional, and she was gossiped about, talked about. So she was known as an unconventional lady. And her father, let's see, he was never really home. He's very wealthy. And his character strengthens too, by the way.
Oh, yes. Oh, definitely. Definitely.
So we have Princess Marissa and Taryn. Taryn is the main story. He is the hero. He's the one that is from beginning to end the whole entire time.
I liked him. He kind of kept everybody pretty much together.
Yeah.
would say Taryn was, I want to say man of God. Mm-hmm. That's what I would say.
Because he was, he put his faith above anything in the whole entire story. Whatever the circumstances looked like, how the darkness was coming on strong, it looked like there was no way out or no hope. It literally looked like, you know, I don't want to give the story away, but let's just say it was looking bad. But he still held on to that faith.
I mean, because he was a young peasant boy, too.
Yeah, Taryn is a peasant. His mother was a peasant. You'll learn later on in the story where he comes from.
Mm-hmm. Changes.
And it's a big secret where he comes from. You'll mm-hmm. learn that. Mm-hmm. But he was a young peasant boy. He lived in the forest with his mother. Mm-hmm. And they owned a little shop. And they would create things and they would sell things. But he was kind of, you know, Menthilthrae was a very wealthy, aristocratic kingdom. So they were kind of frowned upon, you know. But they were very humble and they were very peaceful. So it didn't really bother them. So Taryn, you'll learn and see how he grows in the story. And then Princess Marissa, who is obviously the princess, her, Natalia, and Taryn are actually friends. Mm-hmm. And Natalia's mother looked down upon that because Taryn was a peasant. Taryn's mother was very open to them. And but those were the main four characters.
Yeah, Marissa's character, you know, she's a sweet girl. And, you know, she had it made. She was the princess, mm-hmm. you know. She was taken good care of. She was just one of the ones, carefree type characters. Mm-hmm. She was carefree. So you'll learn also, you'll know as you read the book, that her character, well, I don't want to get into it. So, but anyhow, it's very good.
Let's just say she was not prepared or ready for what was coming her way.
Yes.
That's all I'm going to say.
Yes.
So who is your favorite character? If you had a choice, out of all of them, it could be a minor, it could be the most random characters, but who is your top favorite character?
I would say the young man, Taryn.
Taryn.
I would say him. He had it together. I mean, there was some times, you know, mm-hmm. I think there was one time that it was like he wanted to give up, but mm-hmm. he didn't. But
it's like he's being tested.
He was, exactly. But he was a loving character. And he had respect for his mother. Mm-hmm. He just had respect for, I would say, authority. But anyhow. I would say Taryn is my favorite character. He was in the beginning, and he still was as I was reading, but then everything kind of changes, you know.
When I was writing this book, obviously I'm close to every character in there, so it's very hard for me to say which one's my favorite. But obviously Taryn is. Taryn and Dulcia and probably Natalia. I mean, there's all kinds of characters in this book. Yeah. But those two stand out to me the most. And actually, when I was reading when I was writing this story, mm-hmm. as I came to a close in the story and was finishing up their stories and the struggles they went through, I was actually getting a little emotional as I was writing.
Yeah,
because it was becoming so real, and these characters so real to me. Mm-hmm. And so actually, when I was writing, the ending, it was very bittersweet to me. And it was a matter of me writing this story for a very long time. So, in my head, these characters are becoming real. Mm-hmm. But those are a few of my favorite characters.
You know, and then as I got further into the book, you know, I started developing, you know, I started liking the characters that I didn't really care for in the beginning, you know?
Yeah.
Because everything changes.
Mm-hmm.
And I can understand what Josh was saying when he said teary-eyed as he was writing, because I was getting teary-eyed as I'm reading, you know, because, like I said, there's, you know, you can get emotional.
So that leads to our next question. Did any of them impact you? And could you relate? So
yes.
What, if you could remember a situation or character, which one impacted you?
Oh my goodness.
How could you relate?
Goodness gracious. I think Natalia, like I said, as I was reading, she really touched me. She really grew. And Prince Philip. You know, I believe each one of them in their own way, what they needed, you know, on this journey, because they do go on a journey. So I want to say Lady Natalia, you know, I want to say her.
That's good. And we skipped over a few characters, I'm just realizing.
Yeah, there was the...
There was, they had the darkness, and this...
Lilith was one of the...
And the list story there is obvious light versus dark.
Mm-hmm.
The darkness, there's particular characters who you will see throughout the trilogy. Characters such as Fiara and Lilith. Fiara is actually, this Mintlethwaite is actually a kingdom that was originally ruled by goddesses. It was a pagan kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
And King Yehoshua that came in, he is the one that conquered the darkness. So these temples were laying in ruins. And so the people were going by the new way of light. And so... That's what this story is about, is about good versus evil, light versus darkness, is inspired by the Bible. So there's a big clash going on. And so there's a few characters of darkness. There's all kinds of them, but two that stick out the most is Fiara and Lilith. And you have other ones like Baphomet and the Abaddon and all of them. Those were dominions of darkness. Those were like their demons. But Fiara, You'll hear that name throughout the story. What do you think of Fiara? She actually represents, in the Revelation, the Whore of Babylon. She is the beast. So what do you think of her?
She was a one to lure, right? She was.
Yes.
I would say she was more like a temptress.
Yeah, she's fire
that
goddess.
That spirit, you know, that temptress spirit. Gotta watch out for that kind of spirit.
So Lilith, you'll see Lilith, she is in the story. She is Marissa's caregiver. And Lilith was there for a very long time. You'll hear her story in the book. I don't want to give anything away, but she is Marissa's caregiver. What did you think of her?
She just let the darkness overrule.
Could you see her character in other people in this world? Or?
Oh yes, definitely. Definitely, because that's what we have to be aware of, because if you can't forgive, you know, if something has happened to you and someone has hurt you and you can't forgive that person, you know, that spirit, your heart, you've got to guard your heart, because if you allow things like this get to you and you can't forgive,
kind of turns your heart to
stone.
It
will. I mean, because it's like you'll be resentful and you just hold on to it. Because there's people that does, and they just hold on to it and they get angry and they get sick. And this character Lilith, she had the darkness living in her. And she just couldn't let it go. I mean, it just...
You'll see it kind of consumes her. You'll see how these characters are consumed on what they're going through. And that's the main key that keeps things going in the story. So, did the books meet your expectation? Like, when I told you that I was writing a story, and it was fantasy, and when you went to go read it, Did it pan out the way you thought it would? Did it meet your expectations?
Well, I didn't know what to expect, because I've got to say, I got to bring this up, because when Joshua was in the fifth grade, right, he started drawing these pictures. One of them was Fiara.
Yeah, actually, I have this written.
He started drawing these pictures. Mm-hmm. He says, one day, I'm going to write a book.
And you'll see this, you'll read in my, I think I've written in my biographies and different things on Amazon that this story actually happened because of pictures.
Mm-hmm.
I was in junior, I was in about fifth grade, junior high. The public school system started talking about Greek mythology, gods and goddesses, and that sparked an interest. And I was drawing these characters. So this book was inspired initially from that. And I'll say that this story has changed a lot. When I first started writing this story, which I was in high school when I first started writing the story, it was very, God wasn't the center of it. It was very a typical fantasy. It had witches in it, magic. It was like a typical fantasy. And, but it really wasn't, going anywhere. It didn't have any deep notes or high peaks, because it really wasn't inspired and influenced by real life. But as I got older, I mean, I'm 33 now. I finished writing book one about 5 years ago. I finished a trilogy altogether a couple years ago. You know, of course, I went through a big changes throughout my life, going through whatever I went through, being reborn again, saved, wanting to live my life for Jesus and do go by his will. The story started having a big change in it.
You know, too, when I first picked up his manuscript, and
years.
I was reading, it was years ago, and I was reading, it's like, in my mind, it's like, how, Josh, do you come up with this? And it just inspired me, just reading this book. It was like, of course, I would have never been able to come up with, you know, these books, but it's very, very inspiring, you know, because like I said, as I'm reading and further on into the books, I put myself there, you know, I can relate, because this to me is real life. This is stuff that we deal with every day. And, you know, and when we talk about these creatures, these dark creatures of darkness, you know what? It really does lure out there. We don't see it, of course not, but this is in the spiritual side, you know? But it's real. Hell is real. Heaven is real.
I'm going to, since we're going there, I'm going to ask you this question.
Yeah.
There seems to be, in today's society, We often get stuck in these labels and these things as, I'm a Christian, so I do this. They're of the world, they do that. When you break yourself away from labels, when you live your life truly for God in a spiritual way, you'll think differently. But there have been some people, you know, who say they're Christians, they label themselves as a Christian. They don't want to read it because they say it's too dark. They have people of the world that say they don't, you know, believe in Christianity, whatever. They don't want to read it because they say it's too Christian. But, so I guess my question would be, how would you answer to people who, Christians who say that they don't want to read this because it's too dark, you know, or people say that they don't want to read it because it's
Christian. You know, you can't really, regardless, I mean, like, I would say to the ones that would say, you know, if it's too dark, Christians that say it's too dark, hey, this is reality. The Bible, it's even in the Bible, you know, they talk about hell and what happens when you go to hell, you know? So you can't be, you know, I would say this book is not scary. This is an eye-opener, you know? And for me, you know, hey, I'd much rather be scared and get my life together, you know, really, truly. And for people that's, you know, that's not a Christian, they say, but still, regardless, you know, it's a good book. And this, this will reach out to you. Maybe there's something that you know, as you're reading this book, that relates to you, and you know, and you don't want to live like that, or you don't want to be like that. You know, you can change. You can change your life. You know, because there is a real darkness. There is a real light. It is for real.
Yes. And this, like I said, this story was inspired by the Bible. Anybody who studies the Bible, you will see. It's deep. Everything's in there. So,
because you know, if you think about it, you know, let's just say the medieval Renaissance. You know, I can relate to it today. You know, today's world. It's just like the Bible never changes.
Right.
You know, never.
I had this review. Someone wrote a review of my book. She had a long review, but the line that stuck out to me the most that I thought was really cool, she said that this book is, it's like a classic fantasy with a heavy dose of faith.
Yes.
And I thought that was really cool, because that's...
That is good.
That's what it is.
That is good. That's mm-hmm. a good way of putting it.
Yeah. Because it has your fantasy elements in it, but it revolves all around the, it's like the spiritual world gone physical. That's all I can say.
Well, yeah, because reality, if you look at the world today that we live in, really, mm-hmm. and that what we're heading into, that's basically that it's, you know, I read it in this fantasy book, mm-hmm. you know? And yeah, I want to be ready. I want to be prepared. I don't want something to say, you know, the doors just open and it's like, what just happened?
Right.
I want to be ready at all time, you know?
To be vigilant. The Bible says to be vigilant.
Yes, vigilant.
So did you feel touched by The Last Legend in any kind of way? Spiritually, yes. Emotionally?
Yes, I did. Spiritually and emotionally. Because like I said, when I read this book, you know, as I'm through the second book, the third book, you know, I relate to now, you know, and how I would handle things. I mean, you know, I read the Word too, and I'm just saying, you know, we have to be ready. I would say, pull on our full armor of God.
Mm-hmm.
Because we really do have to be ready, you know, for anything that comes our way. Be prepared, you know, how to handle. Because you know what? I've heard, you know, why did God, if something drastic happens, I don't believe it's from God. And, I mean, there's things that's happened in my life. I don't blame God for what happened. Like the...
God will allow things to happen for His glory.
So we can hold that against them, or we can just, you know, just go forward.
Right.
But there was something I was going to say and it slipped my mind, but it'll come up later.
Okay. So do you have a favorite excerpt in this, any of the books, like a favorite?
Oh yes, I do. It's in The Last Legend. Unto the End.
So, Unto The Last Legend, Unto the End, is book two. They have three books. They have Awakened, Unto the End, and Forever. Mm-hmm. So, Awakened, Unto the End, Forever.
And you know, there's some passages I wanted to read in this book, but like I said, it's all through the book. The books are very good. And this is one, it says, in a world that has nothing to offer but darkness, we have to believe in something that saves our souls. Light is the only way. What is the worth of living upon the earth with a dark soul? What is the worth of living such a dark life? We have to believe in the light we have to now more than ever. And this is something that Natalia had... told Dulcia, this is the two characters.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was something else that Natalia also was speaking to Dulcia about, because it's something that Dulcia goes through in this story. And it's, and this is what she said, there are always, this is Natalia telling Dulcia, there are always second chances, and we do have second chances, but we have to accept it. And we must accept those chances before it's too late, you know? And then she said in the storyline, I want to go ahead and read this because it touched me. Call out to him, Dulcia. This is Natalia telling Dulcia this. Call out to him. He knows your pain and suffering. We go through pain and suffering every day. And if we choose to carry it, shame, shame on us, because there's times, I'm telling you, I have carried, and it's not fun. It just makes you sick. Mm-hmm. It literally, you know, your health declines. So I would say, you know, it's not going to hold on to. It's to call on the Lord. Mm-hmm. Help, let him help you go through this. You know, you just give it all to him. So basically she was saying, he is waiting for you. He will forgive you, that he will. Mm-hmm. You ask him, he will forgive you. And she said, ask him to be part of your life again. Ask him to lead you. He loves you. And she says, I speak the truth, because darkness has nothing to offer but lies and pain and suffering. That's all that darkness has to offer, is pain and suffering. And it says also, and she also said, learn to wear the armor of King Yahshua. But you know, this is Yahshua in the storybook, but learn how to wear your armor in Christ. This is what touched me in the last legend to the end.
I think it sounds awesome when other people read it out loud, because I've always read it to myself. So when someone else reads it out loud, it's different.
It's powerful. Mm-hmm. It really is, because if you are suffering and if you have pain, you don't have to handle it your own. Mm-mm. You know, because I'm telling you, it will eat you alive. I know that. Mm-hmm. And there was one morning, it was 2:00 in the morning. You know, I went and laid on the living room floor when everybody was asleep, and I cried out to the Lord, Lord, I can't handle this anymore. What I was going through, I could not handle it on my own. So I told him, I just release this to you. I can't handle this. This is like eating me alive. And you know what? After I did that, I've noticed after that, I had peace. I don't have to worry about this anymore. So whatever you're going through, you can do the same thing.
Right.
You know, it's nothing to be ashamed of.
Right. Call out to God. Nothing. Thank you for bringing that up. That's, so you can see the story was is very relatable. Mm-hmm. There is a lot of deep emotional situations in this story. And as a matter of fact, I was told by someone else who reviewed my book that Dulcia is one of the main characters that really touched them, and how they could really relate to Dulcia. You'll read in the story how Dulcia, her story is very tragic. It's not only tragic, but she rises above, obviously. You'll read it, and she is, that's what I said, Dulcia is one of my favorite characters, because she represents someone who backslides. She represents someone who's a Christian that backslides. Mm-hmm.
I can relate to that too. Mm-hmm. I can. I think we all can. This is not funny games. It's real.
This is real life.
You know, you don't want to mess your life up.
Right. So, would you tell others about The Last Legend?
Of course. I'm telling you all about The Last Legend. I will rate it a 10.
A 10, well, thank you.
A 10. I really would.
Bella's joining us for the interview. Mm-hmm. So,
because this book, Christians or non-Christians, this book is a fantasy book. And this, like I said, this relates me, this just relates to the world that we live in today, in our life. Really, it's not to be scared about.
Right.
You know, if you're scared, then there's, you know, that means you have to search yourself, check yourself.
So, let's see, do I have any more questions? So that was all the questions. Well, thank you, Mom, for this interview, inviting
you
to this interview. I would like to invite other people for interview who have read my book, read the books.
I just didn't want to go to, because you see, once I start chattering, I start talking, I'll give the book away. So I've got to just kind of like, you know, sit back, control myself.
So, I'll have more and more videos with interviews, me talking about the book. If you liked what you hear, you can go get this book at Amazon, BarnesandNobles.com. You could request this book at different bookstores. You can go to TheLastLegendAwakened.com. I'll have the links below. You can search that out and go get them. Also, if you like, just hit me a thumbs up if you like this video. Subscribe to this channel. I'm planning on making more videos. But that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching the video.